Today we're going to work in section 3.5, and in section 3.5 we're going to be dealing with rational functions. We're just going to review quickly the domain of a rational function. We're going to get into vertical asymptotes, horizontal asymptotes, then we're going to get into actually graphing a rational function here. So the first thing we're going to do here is we want to look at what is really a rational function. And remember that a rational function key word here is it's the ratio, see ratio is part of rational, of two polynomial functions. A rational function is the ratio of two polynomial functions. And more commonly you'll see a rational function, just the generic one, written out like this. No, you don't have to memorize this. Did you wet your pants, Parker? That's ace of zero, Goober. I don't want to have to zoom out because then it, how's that? Now, if you want to see this in thy book, they have it in part on page, if you can't read my writing. They put this in the table on, for horizontal asymptotes on page 397. You have it right here, okay? All right. Only thing is here, I'm putting in a few more, because when you got x to, say, the fifth, what would be the next one? X to the 5 minus 1, x to the 4th, x cubed, x squared, x to the 1st, no x. It's just showing descending order in the numerator and descending order in the denominator. That's all this is showing you. All right, it's nothing to wet your pants about. Is everybody with me? Okay. Now, leading coefficient. Who knows what we mean by leading coefficient? Very good. The leading coefficient is the coefficient with the variable to the highest degree. It is the coefficient with the variable to the highest degree. So if we look here, if we have f of x equals 4x squared minus 9 over, let's say I have 6x cubed plus 4x squared minus 8x. What is the leading coefficient in the numerator? What is the leading coefficient in the numerator? What is the leading coefficient in the numerator? Very good, 4. It is the coefficient with the variable to the highest degree. What's my highest degree in the numerator? X squared. Highest degree is 2, so what's the leading coefficient there? 4. Oh my God. What's the leading coefficient in your denominator? Because what's your highest degree in the denominator? So does everybody understand what we mean by leading coefficient? Everybody follow? Because you're going to need to know that, and something we're going to be doing a little bit later here. All right, next thing we want to review here is domain. We want to talk about domain for just a minute. What do we know about domain? Remember, domain is the restrictions on X. It's what X can or cannot be, right? So if we had this, F of X equals 4 over X minus 5. What can X not be here? Positive 5. So my domain here would be what? Negative infinity to 5 or 5 on to infinity. Does everybody understand? Remember domain. What if I had this one? G of X is equal to 2X over X squared minus X minus 12. What do I need to do in my denominator? Factor it, and it factors as X minus 4 and X plus 3. What can X not be on this one? X can't be 4, and X cannot be negative 3. So what would be your domain on this one? Negative infinity to negative 3, or negative 3 to 4, or to infinity. So everybody remember domains. We did this back. You did it in section 2.1, then you looked at it more in depth in section 2.6, didn't you? So is everybody okay with domains here? All right, the next thing we want to look at here is we want to talk about something called a hole in the graph. All right, we want to talk about when you got a hole in the graph. A hole in the graph. Now, let's say that we have this function here, f of x equals x squared minus 4 over x plus 2. What can x not equal here? X cannot equal negative 2, can it? So everybody agree x cannot be negative 2. So what would be your domain here? So does everybody see your domain? Now, I want you to notice something. If I come in here, what can I do with that numerator? Doesn't it factor as x minus 2 and x plus 2? And what's going to cancel there? So I have f of x equals x minus 2, and we know x cannot be what? Negative 2. Now, when you, excuse me, when you have common factors like this, when you have a rational function and you have common factors, does everybody see how I had the common factor there? That creates what's called a hole in the graph. Okay? You're going to have a hole in the graph. You're going to have a hole in the graph at where that restriction that canceled out. What canceled out here was where x could not be what? Negative 2. So that means you're going to have a hole in the graph at x equals negative 2. Again, your hole in the graph, so everybody see my common factor was x plus 2. So I'm going to have a hole in the graph at where x plus 2 equals 0, which is what? X equals negative 2 here. Okay, isn't that pretty cool? So now let's make a table. X, f of x. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick, and I'm going to slide this up some so y'all should have that. I'm going to start with, say, negative 4 and go negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2. But what do I know I'm going to have at negative 2? A hole. So you better put hole there next to it. Okay. So plug in negative 4 right here. What's negative 4 minus 2? Negative 6. What's negative 3 minus 2? Negative 5. What's negative 2 minus 2? Negative 4. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going here to negative 2, negative 4, and I'm going to go ahead and put my hole there where I won't forget that that's a hole in the graph. All right, what do you get when you plug in negative 1? Negative 3, 0 is negative 2, 1 is negative 1, and 2 is 0. So graph these points. And then we're going to draw our graph. That is a hole in the graph. Now, where do holes in the graph occur? When you have what? When you have common factors. Factors that are going to cancel, those are called common factors. Isn't that pretty cool? How many of you have seen holes in the graph before? Well, now you have. All right, so now that we've talked about holes in the graph, and those occur where you have common factors, let's talk about something called vertical asymptotes. I always love saying that word. I feel like I'm getting away with saying a dirty word. Vertical asymptotes. A vertical asymptote. If f of x equals p of x over q of x, I got a rational function here. F of x equals p of x and q of x. Your definition of a vertical asymptote is if p of x and q of x have no common factors, then vertical asymptotes occur where q of x and q of x is the what? Denominator, where q of x, which is the denominator, is equal to 0. Now again, if p of x and this is a q of x, I don't know why I keep doing that. I think it's from being tired. If p of x and q of x have no common factors, then vertical asymptotes occur where q of x right here, which is your denominator, is equal to 0. Does everybody see that? Now, let's talk a little more about vertical asymptotes. That was your definition. Here's how you get a vertical asymptote, or you should think through them. Number one, the very first thing you should do for is look for and eliminate common factors. Because what do we know about common factors? Those are going to be what? Holes in the graph. Look for and eliminate common factors. That's the first thing you do when you're finding a vertical asymptote. Look for and eliminate common factors. The next thing here, vertical asymptotes occur, let me just write this, vertical asymptotes are x equals whatever makes the denominator equal 0. Again, vertical asymptotes are x equals whatever makes the denominator equal 0. The last thing you need to remember about vertical asymptotes, your graph never crosses or never touches a vertical asymptote. You go to math hell if your graph touches a vertical asymptote. Does everybody follow? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to find some vertical asymptotes here. I think they cut the air conditioning off in here. I mean, I've not heard it running for a while. Sweating like a stuck pig. All right, we ready? Here we go. Let's say that we had this rational function. F of x equals 1 over x plus 2. What is your vertical asymptote going to be here? Do I have any common factors? No. So what's your vertical asymptote? X equals whatever is going to make that denominator equal 0, which is negative 2. Again, your vertical asymptotes are going to be x equals whatever is going to make your denominator equal 0. Let's say I had this one. What do I need to look for first? Common factors here. So if I factor that denominator, tell me first, what can x not be here? 3 and what? X can't be 3 and negative 3. Does everybody agree? But what can you cancel out here? So I have f of x equals 1 over x minus 3, and we know x can't be 3 and x can't be what? Negative 3. So tell me, what do I have at negative 3? Very good. I have a hole in the graph at x equals negative 3, and I have a vertical asymptote where? I have a vertical asymptote at x equals positive 3. So does everybody see the difference between a vertical asymptote and a hole in the graph? Is everybody okay there? Now let's talk about horizontal asymptotes. Now horizontal asymptotes, you've got three cases. You've got three cases for horizontal asymptotes here. Now again, given this rational function here, and again it's just showing the ratio of two polynomial functions, and they're both just showing you descending order. When you look here in the numerator, if n is less than m, that means that the degree in the numerator is smaller than the degree in the denominator. N is less than m. That's what that means, that the degree in the numerator is smaller than the degree in the denominator. Then your horizontal asymptote here is going to be y equals 0. Got to memorize these, guys. We're not going to give them to you on a test. Degree in numerator is smaller than degree in denominator. Horizontal asymptotes, y equals 0. Now the next one here, case 2. N equals m. That is saying that the degree in the numerator is the same or is equal to the degree in the denominator. They're the same degree here. Okay? When the degree in the numerator is the same as the degree in the denominator, then your horizontal asymptote is going to be y equals a sub n over b sub n. Now, what do you think that a sub n over b sub n means? It's really saying y equals leading coefficient over leading coefficient. Y equals leading coefficient over leading coefficient. So when the degrees are the same, your horizontal asymptote is y equals leading coefficient over leading coefficient. Now what's the last one there say? N is greater than m. This is saying that the degree in the numerator is greater than the degree in the denominator. When this happens, what do you know? There is no horizontal asymptote. And you'll deal with those in pre-calc, those of you that go to pre-calc. You'll deal with some of those. You'll get into the slant oblique asymptotes, and you'll get into the parabolic ones. All right, now, something you need to remember about horizontal asymptotes. Your graph may cross the horizontal asymptote. Your graph may cross the horizontal asymptote. You have to check to see if it does. And I'll teach you how to do that. So with the vertical asymptotes, what do you know? And I should say your graph may cross or touch the horizontal asymptote. Remember, with a vertical asymptote, your graph is never going to what? Cross or touch, all right? But with a horizontal asymptote, your graph may cross it or it may touch it here, all right? And I'm going to show you how to check for that. Okie doke. So here we go. Let's say we had this problem. And we're going to answer these things. Vertical asymptote, horizontal asymptote, and does the graph cross the horizontal asymptote? First off, what's your vertical asymptote here? Very good. X equals negative 3. That's my vertical asymptote, because I don't have any common factors, do I? What is your horizontal asymptote? Well, to get that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite that numerator where it's in descending order here. What is the degree in the numerator? What's the degree in the denominator? 1. So my degrees are equal. This is case 2. My degrees are equal. So what is my horizontal asymptote? Y equals negative 1 over 1, which is what? Negative 1, isn't it? Because what's your leading coefficient up here? Negative 1, and what's your leading coefficient here? 1, and negative 1 over 1 would be negative 1. Now, is everybody with me to here? Question. Is everybody okay? Leading coefficient, negative 1 over leading coefficient, negative 1 over 1 is negative 1. All right, now, does the graph cross the horizontal? Well, let's make sure I spell the word right. Horizontal, I don't know that word. Does the graph cross the horizontal asymptote? I was reading it. I was like, what did I say? You take your horizontal asymptote and you set it equal to your function. Here's how you check to see if your graph crosses the horizontal asymptote. You take your horizontal asymptote value, which was what? -1, and you set it equal to your function here. And now what you're going to do is you're going to try to solve this. So to solve this, I'm going to cross multiply. So I've got -1 times x plus 3 equals 1 times 2 minus x, which gives me negative x minus 3 equals 2 minus x. Now, what's going to happen here when I try to get these x's together? So does everybody see how all my x's cancel there? Does everybody see how all the x's cancel? All right. When all your x's cancel, this tells you that the graph does not cross a horizontal asymptote. All right, now again, when all your x's cancel, that's going to tell you it does not cross here. So your answer here is no. When all your x's cancel, this tells you that the graph does not cross the horizontal asymptote. So, but again, how do you do that? You take your horizontal asymptote value and you set it equal to your function. All right, you're going to cross multiply. If all your x's cancel, then you know your graph does not cross the horizontal asymptote. Is everybody with me on this? Okay, let's say we had this problem. Let's look at one where it does cross so you can see the difference, okay? Let's say that we have this problem. So we want to find our vertical asymptote, our horizontal asymptote, and we want to decide if the graph crosses that horizontal asymptote. So what do I need to do in order to get my vertical asymptote here? I need to factor that denominator. And this time, I don't have any common factors. So what are my vertical asymptotes going to be? X equals 2 and x equals what? -2. Does everybody see I have two of them, don't I? Now, what is your horizontal asymptote? What's the degree here in the numerator? 1. What's the degree in the denominator? 2. So the degree in the numerator is what? Smaller than, less than, the degree in your denominator. So what's your horizontal asymptote? Y equals 0. This is case number 1, isn't it? When the degree in the numerator is smaller than the degree in the denominator, your horizontal asymptote is going to be Y equals 0. Is everybody with me? So now we want to set 0 equal to our function because that's my horizontal asymptote value. And again, we're going to cross multiply. And then I'm going to solve for x. So what's x equal here? X equals 0, does it? Now remember in the other one we did, what happened to all your x's? They canceled, didn't they? So here, I'm getting x equals 0. If you get x equals some number, then your graph crosses the horizontal asymptote at x equals that number that you just got there. So for example, here, if you get x equals some number, I got x equals 0, right? So that tells me, does the graph cross the horizontal asymptote? Yes, at x equals 0. Everybody follow? Why now? Okay. So if all the x's cancel, your graph doesn't cross the horizontal asymptote. If you get x equals some number, then your graph crosses the horizontal asymptote. And you really need to know this to help you when you're graphing. You need to know if that graph is going to cross that horizontal asymptote or if it's not going to cross it. So is everybody with me here? So is everybody okay with horizontal asymptotes so far? All right, the next thing we're going to look at here is we need to talk about some notation here. If I were to have something written like this, the first one up here, and these arrows, I think your book goes and connects them. This first one here, this is read x approaches a from the right. When you see this little plus up here, this is telling you from the right. When you see that little plus up in the exponent, that means that you're approaching from the right here. Okay? And this is just some notation. You're going to see how it works in a few minutes. What do you think the little negative tells you? The little negative tells you from the left. So this one is x approaches a from the left. That's how you read this. X approaches a from the right. X approaches a from the left. Is everybody with me here? All right. Now, what we're going to look at are going to be things like this. Okay, now what is this? How is this read? This is read as x approaches a from the right, f of x approaches what? The what means the question mark. That's how you read that statement right here. As x approaches a from the right, f of x approaches what? Okay? Does everybody kind of see what I'm trying to get you to see there? All right, let's look at where you can see this a little better. Does everybody got that? Here we go. Let's say we had this graph here, and I'm going to zoom in just a second. I want to get it about center there. First off, tell me, what is my vertical asymptote here? I have two of them. What are they? Looks like you've got one at negative 5 and one at negative 4. Positive 4. What's your horizontal asymptote right there? See that horizontal dotted line? What is that? Y equals 1. All right, we're going to get into graphing vertical and horizontal asymptotes in part 2 of the video here, okay? Now, this first part. As x approaches negative 5 from the what? What's that little negative up there tell you? From the left. So everybody go to negative 5, and you're looking at negative 5 here to the left here. Isn't that right there, the left of negative 5? Right here. What are your, now what's f of x the same thing as? Y. So what's your y values going to there? What's on up here forever? Infinity. Okay. As x comes in here to negative 5 from the left, because the little negative tells you from the left, what's your y value is going to? F of x is going to what? Infinity. What about the next one? As x approaches negative 5 from the what? From the right. So now here's negative 5, and we're coming into negative 5 from the right. What's my y value is going to here? Negative infinity. Here's what you're doing. Take the next one. As x approaches, here is 4 right here, right? As x approaches 4 from the left. So what you're going to do is look right here. Here's 4. Look to the left of 4. Does everybody see? Look to the left. And what's your y value going to? Infinity. Here's 4, look to the right, and what's your y value is going to? You just look to the left when it's negative, look to the right when it's positive, and see what your y values are doing on either side of that asymptote there. Now these last two down here are hard. Not. As x goes to infinity, here x is going on to infinity, what's the y value is going to get closer and closer to? 1. When x is going to infinities, whether it's positive or negative, your f of x is always going to be approaching your horizontal asymptote. Okay? That being said, let's say we had this graph. What's your vertical asymptote on this one? What are they? X equals negative 4, and x equals 5. What's your horizontal asymptote? What is it? Y equals negative 2. Make sure you put the x's and make sure you put the y or your teacher is going to mark them wrong. An asymptote is always going to be x equals y equals. All right. So vertical will be x equals some number. Horizontal is y equals some number. Now what about the first one? As x approaches negative 4 from the left. Here's negative 4. When I look to the left, what's my y value going to? Negative infinity. Negative 4. Now again, don't look at the rest of this graph because we're just dealing there with negative 4. When you look to the right of negative 4, what are your y values going to? Positive infinity. What about 5 from the left? Positive infinity. What about 5 from the right? And what are the last two going to be approaching? Very good. Those are always going to be approaching your horizontal asymptote. Now, guys, there is a part 2 to section 3.5. So if you're watching the videos, there is a next part after this one, okay? Does everybody understand?